Okay, welcome to the Lovecraft eZine videocast and podcast. And today is February the 21st, 2016. And, all right, I never do this, but we're going to do a trigger warning today because Kathe Koja is on the show. So that's your trigger warning. So thanks for being on the show, Kathe.
Thanks, Mike. That's quite an introduction.
Yeah, I know. How are you going to live up to that? okay, so I think the book that most people think of when they hear your name is this book here, The Cipher, which Pete's shaking his head no. He's disagreeing with me already.
I disagree as well.
Joe says skin, so I'm not making judgments. I'm saying that that's the book I think of.
To me personally, it's skin, and to a lot of people, it's skin. But I think to also under the body, perhaps, to because there's probably a significant number of readers who might not know Kathy's early work.
And there's a significant number of readers of my YA work who have no idea
about the stuff
that I've done.
Well. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, go ahead, Joe.
Oh, no, that's okay. I just wanted to say is she's such a multifaceted...
Oh, we just lost her.
Oh.
That's all right. She'll come back.
She's such a multifaceted writer. You know, we can look at Cipher and Skin, and then we can jump ahead to Under the Poppy. She has an abundance of young adult material as well. And then there's her theater work. So, you know, we have writers who have as many facets as she does, but not a lot. And I think that makes a difference how, readers perceive her, because it's like, from what direction are they coming to her work? And as she said, she may well have readers that know her for Cipher and Skin, but don't know of her young adult work.
Yeah, and she's what I guess the term is immersive playwright.
Yeah.
She just had a sold-out run of Dracula.
Yeah.
Which... I'm not going to explain this right. When she comes back on, she can explain it better than I can, but basically there's no fourth wall. You know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So while we're waiting for her, Mike, I can show
up. Yeah, let's do the prizes, yeah.
Okay, so this never got drawn last time. It's a kind of a mythos young adult story by Anne
Hi,
Pilcher.
Guys.
Hey, there you are.
I don't know what happened. No clue.
That's okay. If it happens again, just do the same thing. We're gonna announce our prizes, and then we'll...
Okay, that was your trigger warning, Mike. That's what happened.
That's right.
My iPad said, Jesus Christ, I'm out of here.
Just don't go and later on watch the first 2 minutes again.
Okay.
Because while you weren't here, that's when we got all the good shit in.
Okay, so it's called Summoned?
Yeah, it's by Anne Pilsworth. She's one of the authors who is doing the current Lovecraft reread at Tor.com.
Right.
It's kind of a young adult book, but it's very readable. And then this is a new release called Lovecraft Country.
Oh, yeah, right.
By Matt Ruff.
Oh, those are two great prizes. That's a brand new book there. So.
Right, so...
Okay, so why don't we start off talking about Nerve, Kathe? Tell us about Dracula and Nerve, and there's no fourth wall and all that good stuff that you can explain.
There is not. And the Dracula was a lot of fun to do. Nerve is my performance group, performance ensemble, and I write and direct and produce for our productions. And we did Dracula in... the last 2 weeks of January, first week of February, because it's like the dead of the year, right? It's cold, it gets dark very early, the sun is in flight, so it was perfect time to do Dracula. And we did it in a mercantile building in the Corktown neighborhood of Detroit, one of the oldest neighborhoods in Detroit. It's a very old building, beautiful building. And we did the start of the performance in the store windows. So the idea was you watched Renfield in his cell getting out of his straitjacket and escaping to dinner, and then you watch Lucy getting ready for dinner and abusing one of her servants and putting on her makeup and everything. And so then the guests were invited to make themselves aware that they were no longer at the top of the food chain, and then they were taken downstairs by the Brides of Dracula. And they're in the sub-level of the building. We had dinner set up, and in our case, dinner consisted of an empty plate for Mr. Jonathan Harker, who's like the viewpoint character, and Dracula and the other vampires were down there waiting for him. And because it's an immersive performance, there is no fourth wall, everything is happening all around you, and we really go, the designer and I went the extra mile in creating a space that gave you sensory access to the story. We had a plate set up. I commissioned a chef to create food for us that would be sitting on a sideboard. It's not, Jonathan Harker never gets to eat it, but it's there. And it was vegan blood sausage and lentils and gorgonzola. It looked disgusting. It was very good. So if somebody actually wanted to take a taste, it was super good food, and they could have done that. The smell permeated the space. We tried to use everything, light and sound and shadows and everything, to create, the whole point of these things is to create the experience for the patrons of reading a really great book. And that, you know, that getting out of the movie in the middle of the day feeling that you feel when you put down a super great book, that's what we want them to do and to feel, and to, that's the experience we're trying to give them. And it worked.
It's amazing that you use smell as well. I mean, because smell is such an important and powerful attractor. That's great.
And smell gets past your defenses, too.
Yeah, you can't. Yeah, you might be able to block out something visually or whatever, but smell, you can't turn it off.
Right, right. And so, and at one point we had wanted to actually offer them like a tasting menu, but then it did get into people have allergies or people have food sensitivities or yada yada yada, so we couldn't do that. But then we liked it even better because it's like nobody eats the goddamn food, right? It's vampires. Nobody eats the food. Nobody does. Nobody is nourished. And the whole point of this thing was, if you take Dracula down to its essence, and if you outgas, as I did in the script, Van Helsing, who I can't stand. I never could stand that guy. And he went out, and Lucy Suitors went out, and Mina went out. And actually, Mina was there, but she was a performing object. She was not a performer. But the whole point of this thing is about hunger, right? It's about who gets to eat who. Vampires are above humans in the food chain, and humans are really freaked out about that. So that was the conceit of the show.
Didn't you tell me that several guests from the audience would sit at the table as well?
Yes, we had the brides. When the brides would bring people to the sub-level, they would each choose one guest. And instead of acts, we had courses. So there would be three guests chosen per course to sit at the table with Dracula. And as the narrative progressed, we would move the chairs further and further down the table, so you're getting closer and closer to where Dracula's sitting by the end of the night.
Go ahead.
We tried to pick people who would feel, who you could tell would probably be into it, or who would not feel either threatened or overwhelmed.
Yeah.
I mean, some people prefer to just watch, and that's how they get the most out of an experience, and I don't want to wreck that for people. You know, it's like putting a funny hat on someone and going, come on, you'll love it, you know.
Yeah. So the guest that was going like this, you didn't drag them up there.
Or if they were going like this, you know, and they were super into it, it's like they're clearly getting everything out of it that they want to get. I don't want to mess with that. So
yeah
it was a fine line every night, but we tried to stay on the right side of it and make sure that people got the experience, got everything out of it that they could get. And that's kind of the point of everything that we do.
What?
Okay, can you?
Yeah, go ahead.
Sorry, Mike.
No, go ahead.
What I was just going to say is, if we look at you as a writer, Kathe.
Mm-hmm.
Mike and I were talking when you weren't here for a second about how multifaceted your work is. I mean, you have, it's wide-ranging. If we look at, let's say, we'll put Cypher and Skin here, and we'll put your young adult stuff here, and we'll put Under the Poppy there. And we won't even go to how talented you are. That speaks for itself. On
Oh, come on, just go there. Come on. No. Come
well,
on.
I mean, we all know that. And we all know that the depth of your imagination, but you find few writers outside of the Lovecraft, people who dive into Lovecraft and swim in that pond and stay in that pond, you find few writers of your caliber who step away from their own creations and dive so completely into a work like you've done with Dracula. Can you speak about how important that work is, and how it sucked you in, because it's obvious when we look at, like I said, from Cypher to Skin, Under the Poppy to your young adult work, from the various works that are in Extremities, your short story collection, it's beyond obvious how rich your imagination is. So, what lured you to step away from yourself and immerse yourself in silver?
Well, and this is the fifth performance that we've done. I tried to take books that, the one previous to this was Wuthering Heights, which is a huge favorite of mine. I've loved that book since I was 12 years old. Yeah, Wuthering Heights, we did Marlowe's Faustus, which I also love. I love Marlowe. We will talk about Marlowe before we're done here today. And we did a version of Alice in Wonderland that was super fun, very dark. We ran people literally throughout the campus of a church school and started them at one end of the building campuses and then ran them all through and up and down and backstage and up and downstairs and whatever. And we ended up in this...
A version of Alice in Wonderland strained through your brain?
Yes, yes, yes. Because what I tried do with all these stories is I never augment the original writer's works. Everything is adapted straight out of the source material. It's that writer's voice. I don't add my own voice or, you know, cut things or whatever we do. Then that's on me. But it's just a very different way to create that same experience. And actually the first one of these that I did was Under the Poppy. So I started out adapting my own work, which
mm-hmm.
was easier just because I knew the source material, you know, from the inside out. But I tried to let pleasure be my guide in the other work that I chose. And that's why we try to do something that people have some point of resonance to anyway. I found with Dracula that was the most, everybody knows Dracula, everyone knows that story, but not the way we did it. And I have to say that I am aided and abetted by a rotating ensemble of collaborators who we have so much fun together. It's not, you know, it's not only me.
I don't think anyone's done it the way you've done it. It's just amazing.
It was a lot of fun. It was a lot of fun.
And it was hopefully well received.
We sold out. We sold out the run on opening night. From the time I went to the space to, you know, to do the show for opening night, and by the time I got home and then checked my email, we were sold out for the run. So it was right. It was very well received.
Right.
Yeah, so when I imagine, you know, when I first heard that you do this, you know, I imagine, okay, you know, there's a theater and, you know, all the normal stuff, but it's a different place and location.
And it's different every time, yeah.
Yeah.
It's different every time. And, like, when we did Marlowe's Faustus, the space that I was originally looking at, a really nice warehouse space, ended up falling through like at the last minute. And I walked out of the meeting with a splitting headache thinking, I have taken ticket money from people for a show that I now have nowhere to present. That's okay. That's okay. I can deal with this. And I ended up touring a church, a Unitarian church in Midtown Detroit, and they were showing me their event spaces, and I'm thinking, whatever. And she said, oh, and we do rent the sanctuary. What? You rent the sanctuary? We can do it in the actual church? Fuck yeah. So that's where we did it. And it was so, and the Unitarians were so cool. The Unitarians were like, I said, do you want to like see the script or anything? They're like, Kathy, we're Unitarians. That we couldn't care less. We're all about literature, and yeah, no, we're not gonna make a fuss. So because it was in the church, we got to have all that resonance of bringing, you know, the devil into church. And when people came in to be seated, we held them in the narthex, and it also gave me a chance to use the word narthex in conversation, which you don't get. So we brought them all in there, and we just held them, and when the show began, Mephistopheles came down the stairs from the choir loft and slammed open the doors of the church, and that was the show, and then people walk in. It was pretty sweet.
So your literature is Diamond the Gallus. You like to create hell in church.
And I like to get the most out of every space that we've been in. Like, we use the church and school campus for Alice, and the actual Wonderland, you know, we led people on the journey, but the tea party and some of the other augmented rooms we did were on the third floor of the building in this little creepy little preschool. Well, it wasn't creepy till we got to it, but like a little preschool thing with the tiny chairs and stuff, and to give people that feeling of being totally elsewhere and of losing their bearings running through this dark building at night. I mean, it's basically just a church and school building campus, but when it's night and you're following the White Rabbit and all this other shit's going on,
and Alice
was a puppet, was a performing object puppet, because I didn't want to have an Alice character, because then everybody just sticks to Alice like glue, right? So that's not fun.
Yeah.
Did you serve tea at the tea party?
Pardon me?
Did you serve tea at the tea party?
No, we did not serve tea because there was no room.
Oh, okay.
No room for you. No chairs. Although they did get hats. They all got hats.
Oh, and, that's
cool. Oh, it was great. And I'll tell one more anecdote from Alice. In our version, the Tweedle, there was only one Tweedle, and she was having a lot of emotional problems because her other Tweedle was gone. And so she was restricted, the performer was restricted to one room that was set up like a slumber party, like a little kid's slumber party. And you could paint your nails and have candy and play games with her and all this stuff. And the performer was not allowed to leave the room. So she had to like try to invite you in. And at the end of it, the Red Queen burst in upon her and just straight up murders her and drags her little body into the hallway and leaves her for dead on a couch. People were aghast. People were so upset that they walked past her, because at first we were going to have her dead on the floor, but we said, no, she's going to get squished. Someone's going to walk on her hands in the dark. This isn't safe. So we said, Marianne, let's kill you and throw you on the couch. So we killed her and threw her on the couch, or Rachel killed her and threw her on the couch. And as she was lying on the sofa, and, you know, she has to remain there for the balance of the, there's no backstage. She has to remain there for the balance of the performance. So she's lying on the sofa, and as people walked past, you know how people go past a coffin at a viewing in a funeral home, and they touch the body? They did that with her on their own. The patrons just went by and touched her, and some people cried, and it was fantastic. And I never saw that coming. I never thought they would react so strongly. People didn't want her to die because she was harmless and friendly.
And so that's got to be immensely satisfying to you as a writer of this type of immersive fiction.
It's a lot of fun because it's the one thing you can't get from, I mean, I could follow people around when they read my stuff, and I have considered it.
But that might be weird, yeah.
Right, and like look over their shoulder and shit and go, what do you, what part is that? Yeah, yeah. Is it good? Isn't that funny? Did you see what I did there? But you can't get that experience from them. You can't watch them interacting with whatever it is that you're trying to do for good or bad, but this way you can.
Is that one of the reasons why you started, you've written books for so many years, is that one of the reasons why you started, why you became a playwright and got into this?
I wanted to see Under the Poppy done as a theatrical performance, and I tried really hard to have other producing entities. At one point it was going to be presented at the Detroit Opera House, and all these other things were going to happen, and in the end, I didn't like the way the direction, I just didn't like what was happening to it. It was becoming more and more distant from what I thought it should be. So I said, oh, fuck it. I don't know how to do this, but I'm just going to do this thing because somebody has to do it. And it's not happening the way I want it to happen. And doing that and seeing people interact with the text in that way was so exciting. I don't know how many of you guys are familiar with Sleep No More, the Punch Drunk production that started in Boston, I think in 2009, and then they moved it to Chelsea, to New York, and where it remains to this day. And the idea with a Punch Drunk production is the same. It's super immersive, super high-end, and you're let loose in the site to follow the narrative or not as you please. And once I knew that I wanted to do this, I went to see the Punch Drunk Sleep No More when it was in Boston, just to see how is this done, you know, when you have a big budget and you have lots of room. And I really liked those feelings of being part of the story, being in the story, and what does it do for me now that I know Macbeth, I know the story, but now I've seen it like this, I've been part of it. How does it change the way that I interact with the text? Like at Wuthering Heights, we had a big basket of, I went to every used bookstore in the area and bought all the Wuthering Heights that I could get, and friends gave me extra copies. And it's like when you leave the production, it was called The Heights, here's this basket of these books. So it's like if you don't know this whole story, the book is genius. Read the book. It's right there. Take one. And people did take them.
Well,
I was so happy.
Yeah. Wow. Okay, so you've been
working. Books are fine.
That's utterly brilliant. My God. So you've been working on these things. You've done a number of productions. So as you're writing now, or been writing fiction after you've done a few of these, how does that interact with you? How does what you're receiving from these works, how does that get in you as a writer? Is that altering your writing at all?
That's a really good question. I honestly don't know, and I don't know if I can know. I mean, I don't know if that's something that people will see or we'll see. I don't know. The thing that I'm working on right now, which I'm really excited to tell you about, is a book about Christopher Marlowe, a novel about Christopher Marlowe, who is a huge, huge enthusiasm of mine. I think Marlowe is the best. And I came to him through the Anthony Burgess book, A Dead Man in Deptford. And I don't even know how I came to that book, but that's another thing that changed my life. I read it and said, Christopher Marlowe, what the friggity frick? I must know more about him. This is the greatest thing ever. And the more I read, the more excited I got about him as a dramatist and as a social agitator through his work. And so working on this, the book is called Christopher Wilde. And working on this, I know already there will be some kind of performative component to it, but I don't know that that is changing the way that I'm writing the book, but I know that there will be some kind of performance attached to this book.
Hmm. Yeah, because it sounds like if we took you and you weren't a writer, you would you make these films, which is, in a manner of speaking, they're cold, but you're constantly going back to the theater where you get the audience, where you get that interaction with an audience, and that seems to be really addictive to you. And I just wondered if that you brought any of that back with you.
And I think something you are getting from a performance that, again, is not possible to get, the reader's energy is not available to me when I'm writing, and it's not available to me when I'm writing the performance stuff either. I mean, but after a certain point, when you get them in that space, and every night it's a different experience. We were especially struck by the range of the personality of the audience, say, at the different evenings of Dracula. Some were super cerebral, and some were super freaked out, and some were so into it, just completely intense. They were there for all of it from beginning to end, and that you can't access in the same way. But like any book that we love or don't love, you know, you're bringing your energy to that when you're reading it. But I can't see you do that unless, you know, you let me watch.
Now, this Marlowe book, you're currently writing it, yes?
Yes.
And it's a novel.
Yes.
And do you envision it as like a big, fat novel or?
A big what kind of novel?
Thick, fat.
Oh, I don't know. I won't know until it's done.
Well, I know. Well, some of us just don't know what some of us don't know anything till we write it. Other people have things so intricately laid out and scripted, it's kind of ridiculous. I just wondered if you had an idea. You know, it's.
I don't know. I when I was writing Under the Poppy, I had no idea it was going to be three books. And I'm kind of glad, because I think that would have frightened me. I know it would have frightened me a great deal. I would have said, there is no way I can do this. I can't do anything that, you know, is so intricately plotted, and I don't even have that many post-it notes, so I can't do that. So I'm glad I didn't know. And this I have no clue. And one of the things I'm doing differently with this book is, and in fact the launch of it is the 26th of this month, I'm inviting people to come along for the ride, the creation of it, and I will be posting and talking more about that. And the 26th is actually Christopher Marlowe's baptismal day. They don't know his actual birthday, but they do know his baptismal day, which is kind of great because he was an atheist.
Can you talk a little bit more about that, like on your blog, or what are you saying?
Yeah, I'm going to talk about it on the blog. I will post about it on Facebook and Twitter. And what I want to do is invite people to be part of the creation of the book in a different way, different than anything that I have done before, because I feel so passionate about Marlowe. I mean, I don't know if you guys are aware, but there was this other guy who was kind of contiguous with him. His name is like Bill something, Shakespeare.
He's not very well known.
Super sure. I'm not really into him, but whatever. But because there was this gigantic Shakespeare industry, and not as many people are aware of Marlowe's work, and so much of the work that he did, not only did it blaze the trail for Shakespeare and for other dramatists who came after him, the voice is so beautiful and is unique. And I say unique knowing what that means. I can't stand it when people say things are very unique, or like unique as a synonym for like different or interesting. Unique means
right.
Unique, period. So that is a unique voice. His is a voice that I would really like to introduce to more people, the way Burgess introduced me through Dead Man in Deptford. And you know how there are always writers whose work you just fall in love with, and it doesn't matter if they're contiguous to you in time, whatever. Yep. Like for Marlowe, it was Ovid. He had this huge boner for Ovid. For me, it's Marlowe. For other people, everybody has these people that they just, and once you read their work, you're like, I can't believe I lived my whole life before this without knowing this person. So that's the experience I want to give to people or offer to people with this book.
For people watching now or listening later, because I don't know if I told you, but this will be an audio podcast. I'll send that to you later. I usually do that the next day. But is the best way to do this as of, what, February 26th, you said? Not March 26th.
February 26th is our launch.
Just go to, like, kathekoja.com, or is that the best thing to do?
Yes, and I will be posting the shit out of it, too.
Is that a writer term?
Oh, yeah, it's in the handbook. You'll just keep flipping the pages. You'll get to it.
Basic requirement in the social media era.
Oh, yeah. And for real. And you know what, too? That I know that a lot of people, there are a lot of writers and friends of mine, too, who don't like, who become frustrated at the amount of time it takes to do social media stuff. But I have met so many people and so many other writers and have approached other writers and creatives that way because it's kind of like a safe. You know, you can say to someone, oh, I think you're awesome, and then they can just ignore you if they don't want to talk to you.
Right. No, you're absolutely right.
As many negatives as there are, trolls and bullshit, it's amazing who we get to meet. And it's also amazing who's absolutely wonderful and you, like, and who's an asshole, too.
But you get to have those connections, right, with people that you were never able to do before. That, especially for a writer, you know, you're doing your work in isolation, right? Like the great Michael Ventura thing about the talent of the room. And, you know, you do your work alone in a room. It opens up feedback and interaction and fun. And it takes time, but relationships take time. So.
Yeah.
Rick, I'm sensing you have a question, or am I wrong?
Yes. I'm only familiar with Marlowe from Dr. Faustus. Could you mention some of the other plays he wrote?
Can I?
Oh, boy. I'll be back in 20 minutes.
Right, I know, right. Get out your paper and pencil. His career was cut short, no pun intended, by being stabbed in the fucking eye in a political, whatever, we won't even get into that. Let's.
I think that is so wrong.
They said he was killed in a tavern brawl. Didn't happen that way. Okay, but forget that part for now. The guy lived to be 29, okay? From the time he graduated Cambridge with his master's to the time he died, he had about 5 years. And he did Faustus. He did Tamburlaine Parts 1 and 2, which actually, it was produced in New York, gosh, last year, I think. And I'm blocking on the actor's name who played Tamburlaine. Fantastic production. Dido, Queen of Carthage, which is rarely performed. Edward II, Derek Jarman, did a fantastic film reimagining of that play. Jew of Malta, without which there would be no Merchant of Venice. Beautiful, beautiful poetry, beautiful voice. And what's wonderful about his work is that it is so particular. You are seeing not necessarily a pageant of characters, although there are, God knows, there are about a million people in Tamburlaine. But he really was the first to look at individuals. And his guys, because they're all guys, and his guys always start at the top of their arc, and it's just... And they're aware. They're aware the whole time. It's fantastic. You cannot go wrong with anything. And he was also a poet. His poetry is short collection, small. I mean, come on, the guy died at 29.
Yeah.
Some of us haven't even learned to tie our shoes by the time we're 29.
Okay. Now that you mentioned it, I think I saw it for a second. Is that the play with the gay king?
Yes.
So here you are. You're doing these brilliant plays that you're so attached to, and you're like a Marlowe fangirl. You think you might do Faustus at some point?
We did Faustus.
Oh, you did? Okay. I'm sorry.
Yes. Yeah. No, I would love to do Edward II. And I really urge the Jarman film on you. I know that Derek Jarman is not for everyone, and he may be in a greater taste, but I know, I love him. I love everything he does, and I really love this Edward II. Tilda Swinton does a turn in it that is just, and what is so great, too, about what he does and what I think I always try to emulate in not only in my productions, but in my books, too, you try to give the reader or the viewer, whatever, everything they need, but nothing they don't. There's nothing extraneous in what Jarman does. I try never to put more into the novels than there has to be. Even Under the Poppy, which, you know, as a trilogy, it just is really one long ass book. But it was just too big to fit in one book. Yeah. So, but yeah, everything's there, but hopefully nothing that you need to enjoy or to appreciate or get into the story. Everything else is thrown away because you don't need it.
Okay. So now that you use that particular word, let's change gears a little bit. You just said the word story, and with the exception of extremities, why is it that we don't have, whether it's one big volume or two volumes and a couple of really huge complete collections? Your short work is every bit as imaginative and wonderful as your novels, and it's really criminal that all your short work's not available for readers. And it's not like you just started last week. You've been around a couple of weeks, so...
I have been around a couple of weeks. That was very nicely said, by the way. I have been around a couple of weeks.
It's fucking high time that those of us who have a couple pennies to spend would get to explore the real depth of your short work. So why not?
I don't think that it's a bad idea. Mike just keeps hitting that beer. Mike's like, I don't know why either. He's going to start throwing bottles around pretty soon.
That's right. If you don't do this, I may have to drink one more beer.
Oh, my God. Don't put that on me, Mike. Don't put that on me.
That would be two beers today. We don't want to go there.
That's crazy talk. That's crazy, man. No, I would like to do that. I don't know. I know that there is a... there's a reason to do a big giant, like the giant book of Kathe Koja. Although let's don't call it the Kathe Koja collection, because that's 1K too many.
Look, you got Madonna, you got Elvis, but just put Koja on the cover.
Koja across the top. There are a lot of stories. Yeah. No doubt. I mean, I don't.
You're no second stringer.
Even know for sure how many there are, to be honest with you. I know there's a bunch out there. It is something I would for sure like to do.
But you don't have people not banging on your door saying, hey, lady, come on.
There might be people banging on my door saying, hey, lady.
Just not about that.
Or you want to call them? I don't know.
I meant on this one particular subject, which I think is a gaping hole. It's like, come on. This is a no-brainer.
I would like to do that. I would like to see, although I don't know that you want them all in one big book.
Well, all right, maybe not all. Maybe it's two volumes, but the thing is it seems like it's way to fuck past time that we start seeing a couple of complete collections.
I think it's a great idea.
I do too, and people say that my instinct when it comes to books is pretty good.
Well, I agree with you. They are brilliant stories. No, I'm playing.
I wouldn't be harping if I didn't.
I agree. They should be. They totally should be collected.
So a viewer, Kathy, has a question. I don't understand it. I'm just going to read it.
Okay.
Is probably something that I don't know about yet. Ask Kathy about the production of the Ring Cycle.
Oh, okay. Yeah, we did that last summer. It was a nerve commission to do Wagner's Ring Cycle in 30 minutes. And we worked with a musicologist, musician, adapter of Wagner from, he was based in Boston at the time. And he and I decided to present the music, the Ring Cycle music, in scored for guitar, which sounds counterintuitive, but actually it outgassed a lot of the bullshit, and you could really get at, I'm not a Wagner fan, okay, but you could really get at the melodies, and it was a way to present it. This production took place outside, and so people were in a garden setting, and they were watching a very stripped down version, obviously, of the Ring Cycle. And I am proud to tell you that our Valkyrie was a drone wearing the little helmet with the horns and the braids. So people really like that drone. And that's my show. Rena Hopkins is the designer that I work with on the Nerve Productions. And that was totally Rena's idea. When I told her there was going to be a drone, she said, please let me put a helmet on it. So total props to Rena.
So you subscribe to Bill Nye's quote. He said that Richard Wagner's music is better than it sounds.
I am not a fan, but my task there was to open up the music through an experience that people could see if they had points of resonance, like we were talking about earlier about having receptors for something. If they had the receptors for Wagner, it was my job to present it in such a way that they could take it in. And
you said you worked with a guitarist. Was for the score. What was the only instrumentation used? The single guitar?
Yep.
Was it acoustic or electric?
Acoustic, but it was mic'd.
Okay. That's interesting. Okay.
And a singer.
To another singer. Question. As growing up in Detroit, you grew up there, yes?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. What? You had a healthy music scene more than once there. A lot of us writers are really affected by music. Were you?
Oh yeah. No. I always have music on when I'm writing. As well, there's always a playlist for everything that I'm doing.
Okay, and so don't I. I almost virtually never write without music playing. Are you an instrumentalist, or can you write and listen to people singing at the same time?
It depends. It depends what it is. Sometimes I have to have like the same song playing over and over and over on an infinite loop.
Thank you. I love you. You're the best.
It depends on the thing, whatever it is.
My wife listened to one Black Sabbath song, I don't know, 12, 15 hours a day for 2 weeks in a row.
See? Sometimes you
need it. It becomes just a loop. You can take one song and turn it into a symphony. Yeah. Cool.
Your wife is very patient.
She is. Oh, my God. I just got the new Ben Maunder CD, which is this atmosphere. It's almost ambient guitar, electric guitar stuff. It's just atmospheres. It's only 41 minutes. The other day I played it, and nothing but for 15 hours as I was working on this story. I mean, to me, it became an Aorl Rothko. But she must have, I don't know. No, she's excellent. She just shakes her head and laughs.
So
Kathy, that brings your how does Rick feel about your work?
He thinks it's brilliant.
Good man.
Hey, you know, I a few months ago, I think it was, I listened to a podcast interview where you were the guest, and you said something about your first novel being a paperback horror. That was already the ghetto, and
yeah,
something to
know.
That effect. I noticed Ramsey Campbell tweeted the other day. Let me read this. because I want to get your thoughts on this and horror. An interviewer's husband said of me, if he's so good, how come he writes horror? I send him my compliments for epitomizing an attitude. So.
And the anecdote that you're talking about was when I met my editor for all my YA books, Frances Foster, the late and very great Frances Foster, who was at Farrah Straus, who I worked with on all my YAs. And when I first met her, she bought my first YA, Stray Dog, and we met and had lunch. And she took me on a tour of the offices and pointed out that the FSG books for young readers were like segregated on a different floor from, you know, the real FSG. And she said, Kathy, I feel that you should know. And she was an extremely elegant, very beautiful woman, this very patrician voice. And she said, Kathy, I feel that you should know, because this is your first, you know, it's your first foray into young adult. There are some people who do look down on it because it is for young people, and I hope that won't be a problem for you. And I did not say to the beautiful and elegant Frances Foster, Frances, I come out of paperback horror. There is nothing lower. People cannot think any worse of you. So there is, really isn't anything in this, you know, needlepoint world that's going to bother me. It's okay. It's I'm past that. Yeah. But yeah, there's and back in the day too, there was the same kind of striation between hardcover and paperback. Like, it couldn't possibly be any good if it was a paperback original, which is absurd. But there was that feeling that somehow, unless your book was in hardcover, you know, it wasn't like a real book. I mean, the same way that, can you guys hear Dash? Because Dash is really cutting it up over here.
No, I can't.
All right. But there was that feeling, that real super ghettoized feeling, like this wasn't good writing, this wasn't, it just wasn't. I mean, the same way that people talk about any genre, and about YA, about, you know, romance, which I've never written, about things that can't be good unless they're this and this, when really it's a straight up meritocracy as far as the reader's concerned. Is it a good book? Is it a good story? Is it what I wanted out of a book, period, the end? That's all that matters.
I don't know why people have that attitude towards horror, but I don't know why they have that attitude towards young adult fiction either. I mean, that's what got me through growing up. You know, if I could one day write a book that was for young adults that was as good as something that Daniel Pinkwater wrote, or I can't remember the name of the guy who wrote One Fat Summer, you know, about a kid who's ostracized because of his weight, you know, that'd be great. That'd be an accomplishment, you know.
And those are the times, too, when you can speak really directly to a reader. And I was on a panel once at some book event in Minneapolis, and there were actual young people in the audience. Some were kids, maybe 9, 10 years old. And they were allowed and encouraged to ask questions of the panelists, you know, blah, blah, blah. And this one kid, I wish I could remember exactly how he said it, but the burden of his question was basically, is it true that you know, how can a book be published unless it's good? Because only the good books are the ones that get published, right? And you're like, oh, my baby, oh. And everyone was, oh, what to say? You know, what are you going to say to this child? No, there's shit up to your shins out there, and you're going to have to learn to develop a shit detector as a reader. But you don't want to, you know, come on, it's a little child. You don't want to be mean to a little child, or you just like, you know, but no, there are a lot of books out there that somebody thought were good, but you might not agree with them, and it's up to you to decide, is this a book that I want to read? Is this a book that I like? Is this a book that speaks to me? And that everybody makes that decision. But when you're confronted with a reader like that, how could you not bring your A-plus game? Yeah. Why would you think that you would want to do it any other way, right?
Yeah, it doesn't. Young adult fiction does not strike me as this lesser thing. If you can't write for adults, then you write for young adults.
Right.
I don't understand that mode of thinking.
It should be the opposite. I mean, oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Well, I've often read like people are complain that, like, say, the average American book is written say, at the, quote, eighth grade level. But, you know, when you start thinking about it, if you're going to read everything at the doctoral level, that's like very dense technical material. An eighth grade level book is something like A Tale of Two Cities. You know, it's like, I don't even know about the distinction of young adult. It's just, does the book interest you or not?
Right, and it's a marketing distinction too, right?
It's called The Forgotten Piece of Hell. Did you ever read it? It's by Patricia McKillop. And when I read it, it was...
What was the title? The
Forgotten Beasts of Eld. It's just, she's a fantasy writer, high fantasy writer.
Okay.
I don't know if she's high when she writes, but never mind. Okay, so... She
I'll let her know.
Book.
Right, drunk, edit sober, but yeah, go on.
Okay, I read this book, I don't know, when I was 20, and I thought it was a brilliant, lovely little story in the style that she wrote in, like when she wrote a Riddle Master of Head trilogy. And I found out years later, when she originally released it, it was a young adult style book. So,
well, there are people that About to Kill a Mockingbird, right?
I was just going to bring up Harper Lee. It's like, sweet Christ, come on. If we just look at sentences, pick a sentence from To Kill a Mockingbird, yeah, anybody who's been to seventh grade can read the book. Is the fucking book great or is it not great? That, who gives a rat's ass what the marketing tag is?
And you know what one of the greatest books in the world is written for very small children? Okay, and there are, and examples can be made for a lot of books, but for me, the example is The Velveteen Rabbit. And
oh,
I did not read The Velveteen Rabbit as a kid. I didn't read it till I was an adult, reading it to my son when he was very small. And the rabbit asks a question in that book, which is probably the question of human life, of any life. What is the use of becoming real and knowing love, you know, if it ends in death? I don't know. You tell me, right? I mean, come on. Who can look at that and say that that's anything other than... That's literature. That's what literature is supposed to do. That's the question.
Absolutely.
The bunny sitting there on the pile waiting to be burned because the little boy had scarlet fever and they took his toy bunny away and threw it on the fire. I mean, you know? But that's a child's book, so it's not, like, good.
Yeah, so it's not important, right?
Right. So it's not important.
Well, has a book been written ever that's better than Green Eggs and Ham?
Well,
what?
Sneetches. The Sneetches, right? No Sneetches. Kind of Sneetch is the best on the beaches, bitches. That's the takeaway, right? That's great.
Hey, I'm a star.
Are you a Starbelly Sneetch?
Yes, I am.
Oh my God, you a Starbelly Nars? Oh my God, see, but we could still be friends.
Right. See, I don't.
Not good friends, but friends.
If I ran the zoo,
how can anybody not love one fish, two fish, three fish, blue fish?
Okay, get this. When I was in 11th grade and I was taking Latin, our teacher for a year assignment said, while we do this class, because we were reading the Aeneid, she said, you must take an English book and translate it into Latin for me.
Oh, wow. So
my project that I turned into her was Unus Piscis Duo Piscis.
That's awesome.
That's awesome. How does it read in Latin, though? I mean, how
really
does it read?
Really badly.
It's so cool. No, see, and that takes you back to what is the pith of the book, right? What's the heart of the book? If the heart of The Velveteen Rabbit is about, you know, love and death, if the heart of The Sneetches is, come on, Starbelly, whatever, who cares? That guy is just there to prey on your weakness. Donald Trump, sorry. Something in my throat. that's what it's supposed to do.
Yeah.
Right? It's supposed to speak to you, and it's supposed to be relevant no matter when you read it.
So I just got somebody retweeted, I don't know if you know this guy, says, hey, Kathe Koja is on the Lovecraft eZine talk show right now. This guy's Robert Levy. Do you know this guy?
I do know Robert Levy. He's so cool. We read together at KGB. We had a great time. We had a super great time. He wrote a fantastic story in which he like crossed himself 400 times as part of the story. It was great.
Oh, he did, really?
He totally did. It was an immersive reading. It was really good.
Yeah, he's a great guy.
And a brilliant writer. The Glittering World was just magnificent. Wonderful book.
Oh, and I have to plug another great book, too. I almost forgot. Yeah. That's why I wrote notes. I was fortunate enough to edit Year's Best Weird Fiction, number 2.
Oh, yes, that's right.
Yeah, we know that.
That's
Wait, is that a good book?
Yeah, talk about that, yeah.
It was, and I give tremendous props to Mike Kelly, because Mike did all the heavy lifting on that, and my first experience of editing a collection like this was, an anthology like this, was painless from a editorial perspective, and I got to read a bunch of stories by people whose work was new to me. I got to sample and then offer, you know, this the depth of what is out there, and I really like that definition. I like the calling it weird fiction because I think that's something that people can understand and they don't necessarily feel threatened by it unless they're, you know, easily threatened. But the stories in there, I really recommend everybody rush right out and read those stories because there are some fantastic writers in that book.
Yeah, it's a hell of a table of contents. It really is. You guys did a great job.
And we had a lot of fun. We just had a lot of fun putting that together, and the cover is fantastic. The cover art's fantastic. The whole package is just, it's really great. And I think what Mike is doing here is very smart in having a different editor for each of these.
Yeah, absolutely. Laird and you.
Really smart.
Yes, and I was just double checking for everyone listening to this or watching this. I'm not sure about one. I think the answer is no. I'd have to look, but... first of all, they're both available in print and Kindle, but Year's Best Weird Fiction 2, which you edited, Kathy, is available on Kindle Unlimited. So for those who have that program, you can read the book for free, or as part of your membership, to be more accurate. So yeah.
And what's super useful about all those, any kind of a Year's Best book, but particularly... And then maybe I'm saying this because so many of those writers were new to me and I was so excited to discover these different bylines, is it is a way of getting a sampling and an overview of a field without saying, well, maybe I would like to read more of this, but I don't know A from B. What is good? Oh, all right, I'll just, you know, do this Whitman sampler and, oh, I like this, I like that. Here are voices I want to follow.
Yeah, you did a superb job. I mean, this is what's been going on with Ellen and Terry Windling.
Yeah.
Forever with Year's Best Fantasy and Horror. So many writers that are important to me that I love dearly, that's where I was introduced to them. Just endless lists. And certainly, you know, you had your favorites and giants were in there, but they always were searching for new voices. So... What Mike Kelly's doing with Best Weird Fiction is absolutely wonderful, and I fully expect to see that on all kinds of award lists.
And the using the when you see an anthology collection like Ellen and Terry's, you grow to learn and to appreciate their taste. And I like that Mike is changing it up with different editors because it is like. You get to see the field. It's like the mirror image of that. You get to see the field from, like, the blind man and the elephant. A bunch of different people are saying to you,
right.
Oh, this is cool. This is weird. This is my definition. This is what I think. And they're like, no, I think this. And that, to me, is really valuable, especially in drawing in new readers who might not know where to start or who might really appreciate those different voices, giving them a different, you know, different facet of the literature.
Yeah.
So speaking of this book, you know, I ask people who have been on the show this question, and it's interesting to it's kind of a fluid definition, perhaps. What if someone asked you, Kathy, what is weird fiction? You've edited this book. What is weird fiction? What does that mean? What would your response be?
I think that it both expands and defines the parameters of the possible, because you feel everyone has had the experience of something happens, something odd occurs, something kind of broaches your boundaries, and you look to the person next to you as if to say, did you feel that? Did that just happen? And that's what weird fiction does. It shows you that your boundaries and the world's boundaries and the boundaries of consciousness are more elastic than might have been suggested to you before. But that someone else has seen it too. Someone else knows. And you can trust your own sense and instincts that there is more, however you define more.
Things are not as they seem.
Things are not as they seem.
And I just adore that our field, weird fiction, at this point, is as expansive as it is. I mean, that panoramic horizon that we're looking at, wow. You almost need to have the ability to rotate your head as far as an owl to take it all in.
Although I'll tell you one thing that is the one thing that I don't like is that I only read in English. I'm unilingual. And so unless things are translated, all that, you can call it the year's best weird fiction in English, because I can't, you know what I mean?
Yeah,
I don't know what else is out there. I have no idea.
Yeah.
Well,
unless it's, you know, been translated.
Unless you're going to have, I don't know, we'll say Michael Sisko as editor one year, that's pretty much how it's going to be, no matter who we mostly have for editors. You know,
that would be nice, though, wouldn't it? I mean, wouldn't it be nice to have to be able to open it up more?
Yeah.
I mean, the Vandermeers are always promoting outside. And if we look at, we'll pick on Karin Tidbeck for a second. Thankfully, that volume is translated into English, but who else is there that we would not be able to read? That list must be as long as my arm. And I'm sure we're
frustrating, so frustrating.
Yeah. But, you know, all we can do is keep our talents crossed and hope we see more great translations of
and keep asking for it too, right? And let people know that that there's a market and an appetite for, you know, fiction translated for English speakers.
Yeah, I mean, I can remember 20 years ago when Sisko was turning me on to a lot of the Eastern Europeans that I hadn't discovered. And these days, he's pointed me to South America. And when we look at what's going on there, as well as other parts of the world, it's just staggering, the richness of their literature. The new vistas that are being opened up. It's amazing. It makes us far richer as readers. And for those of us who write, as writers as well.
You know, sometimes I think about this, and technology is always advancing, and automatic computer language translation is obviously not very good at this point. You know, it's okay. Somebody writes something on Facebook, you can hit the translate button, kind of understand what they said in a lot of cases, but I wonder if it'll reach the point where it's so sophisticated that, you know, any book will be available in any language automatically.
But if you've read, like, if there's a writer who I can only read Arthur Rimbaud in English, but when I read different translations of poems of his, and you tend to imprint on the first translation you've read as if that's like the right one, but it's hair-raising, the difference in the shades of meaning that one translator chooses to emphasize over another that is doing, no, mine is just a literal translation, or it's a real slippery slope, and it would be hard to get a universal translation of anything. I mean, except like Stop or McDonald's or, you know, something really easy.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I mean, when you think about the intricacies of language, and poetics. So many of our best writers, it's not simply prose. I mean, they have poetry in their toolbox, and they bring it to the fore. It's in their sentence structures. It's in the flow of their paragraphs. I don't know that we ever get a machine that has that ability, that talent to understand that. Be nice.
And of the books of mine that have been translated, I mean, because I can't read them, I don't know, but I have talked to some of the translators, and it's such an act of, it's really a rewriting of the book, but it's so difficult because they're balancing the sense, they're balancing the poetry, they're balancing the meaning that they need to convey in the language that they're using to translate it. It's a real act of scholarship and artistry when it's done well. It's like a miracle.
Well, it has to be. Look at Burroughs. All right, let's pick up. You're Kathe Koja. We're talking to you. Let's pick on Skin, which remains my favorite book of yours. Think of the language there. Yeah, we could say that. Yep, that's the puppy right there. You know, we could open a page and we could pull out all kinds of sentences that seem to be easily translatable. But when we look at your usage of the language,
I know it's French, I know it's Spanish, I know it's German, I'm not sure if it was translated in Japanese. I know there were multiple translations of it, and even, I mean, that's kind of the joke about the book and its cover. There are, and I've done that in presentations that I've done with younger readers, too, and show them the different translations of Stray Dog, which has also been multiply translated, and say, look at all these book covers. It's the same book, but how do you feel when you look at this cover? How do you feel when you look at that cover? How do you know, how these covers make you feel? To let them know that their experience of reading starts at the moment that they, you know, they lock eyes across a crowded room with the book.
Oh yeah, absolutely. It's the first dance. The cover is everything.
And it's so integral to the way we experience. It's the handshake. It's the first moment of meeting. It sometimes it decides whether or not you're even going to read the damn thing.
The front cover is you're standing, let's say, in a bar, and you turn and you see the woman, and you, wow. And then you turn it over, and we have the back cover matter, which is, hi, how are you? Can I buy you a drink, let's say? You know, which, unfortunately, back cover matter these days all too often is, shit, why read the book now? Because they just, you know...
Spoiler alert!
Telling me the whole goddamn thing, and ruined it.
And that's a real art too. I mean, you know who's an artist? Whoever writes those little encapsulations for the Library of Congress. I love it, dude. Look at some of those things. It's amazing. This book is about blah 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 blah, like in a sentence, you know. And if you get semicolon, you have really done something, right?
They used to always be. When I was a kid, that one line would always be in the front of the book, in the inside, you know, cover. And often I would look at that instead of looking at the inside flap or the back of the book.
Very smart.
See, my thing has been forever front cover, page one. If read page one, go to the back. Not nowadays, but in the old days, go to the back. Okay. And then, if you hooked me with your language on page one, and there are those books, you know, like I'm constantly pulling out City and Night to read the first couple of paragraphs on this chat thing, it's just, how can you not take that book home? Skin, you know, read page one the way I did in, what the hell, I don't even remember what store it was all those decades ago. But that's it. You know, you're halfway through page one. You're taking this girl home. We're sleeping together. That's the end of that. It's the only way.
And you, when you meet writers like that, or you know any artist, individual art or music, you know right away sometimes that like this thing is for me. This is the thing that I want. And know when you don't want things too, you're like, yeah, I'm good. No thanks. Pass that on. But we are so serious now, Mike. Isn't it time to be a little bit silly? Is it time to be silly? We said we were going to talk shit and stuff, and I don't know where we are time-wise. I don't have a time device.
Well, I don't want to keep time in the world for you, so.
Yeah, I don't want to keep you too long.
The note of meeting an author and learning about their work, I have fallen in love with certain authors and really enjoyed their work and then met them and never read anything else by them again.
Yeah. Or you read an interview and you go, but that guy's an asshole. And then you just think it's weird.
Or
and
that
like,
guy's a cokehead.
Yeah, right. You know, I know. That's sad.
And then you sit there and it's just like, this was brilliant work, and you became an asshole because of it. And it's just not worth it anymore. And I've seen it happen a couple times. And you know, I've stopped promoting that writer, and I've stopped reading their stuff, and eventually sold all their stuff that I had. Sometimes meeting the author is the worst thing that you can do.
Often meeting the author is the worst thing you can do. Depending on what their current mood is, or if they had coffee or something, who knows?
Yes.
No, and that holds true. I mean, I'm a huge fan of John Malkovich's acting, but I have read interviews with him that were so not good, and you're like, I still want to enjoy his work, but it does. It's like peeing in the pool, right? You're like, man, now I know that that's there. I can't forget about it. And that takes us back to the beginning before we went live about what do you do with a super problematic. Wagner is a good example. A lot of people can't stand his music because they can't stand him. And you can't blame him. I mean, I'm not a fan. He was a dick to Mendelssohn. What are you going to say? On the other hand, doing that, you know, Wagner show, the music is damn catchy. I can't say it isn't. But that's a slippery slope for everybody. You have to say, how much do I need or want to know about this artist?
Right.
And is it going to ruin my fun? So I'm a bad person. In case you wanted to know, I'm a really bad person in every possible way. So take that under advisement.
I think I was just listening to an NPR article, an NPR interview the other day that talked about how when Ghost Set a Watchman came out, all these adults who had named their kid Atticus.
Yeah.
Bad.
Yes. It's like somebody played a trick on them. People got really upset.
Yeah.
And yet when you look at the publishing history of that project, that was the book. That was the first book, right?
Right.
And then they said, this isn't going to fly. You're going to have to do something else.
Let's be careful about this because when she was 87 when it was published, I don't know how lucid was she. It's let's say, okay, here's this composer that I like named Bruckner. And Bruckner wrote these massive symphonies in the Romantic style. And yet he's got symphonies 1 through 9. But if you look at it, he also has symphony number 0 and 00. And these were student works he never intended to see the light of day, where he was experimenting. And he may have recycled themes, he may have modified them. If this was her study symphony, did she ever really intend it to see the light of print? I mean, someone cashed in here on her reputation doing something she may not have wanted to have done. Let's not give this book too much credence. It is what it is. It takes nothing away from To Kill a Mockingbird.
But don't you think it's useful to have, now that it is out in the world, and whether or not she as a person was taken advantage of is a whole different story, and I don't know enough to discuss it.
If you look at Beethoven's works, we're talking music here, you have his sketches where he develops a melody. He writes, I didn't like that. He changes it. Mm-hmm. And then you look, it's like, hey, here is that famous piece of music from the Ninth Symphony that they used on CBS News forever. Well, when you see how that evolved, it wasn't like that at all when it began. That's very useful for a student of musicology.
Absolutely, and wouldn't you like to read Bach's laundry list? I would. I would love to see anything that but that's talking from a fan's perspective, right? I would love to see anything that he wrote that would aid me in my appreciation of what he's done.
All right,
but would he want me to see it? That's a different story.
Right. Now, the thing is, so I think when you talk about that particular book, you take that with a lots of, I understand that, a grain of salt, this has a bearing on it developed eventually into Kill a Mockingbird. That's how I look at it.
Yeah.
And I don't think that anybody would... I don't think she as a person, this may have been so far removed from her own wishes or wants that might make it, you know, actionable that it was even published. But that isn't anything that we can know just looking at the text. And, you know, I'm a hypocrite too, because I'm saying that, and there are books in that hallway closet right there. You can't see it, but there's a hallway closet there, and there are several novels in there that you will never see.
Well,
let's see, when you're like 87, you won't have control over that.
I'm burning them things.
young lady, step back a minute. 1996 or so, Michael Sisko comes over, and Joe Polar's sitting next to him on somebody's sofa, and Michael Sisko starts to read from a novella. And of course, 20 minutes later, and he's done reading. And I said, as I often did, can I have the hard copy so I could take it home? Of course, I wanted to read the end of novella. And I took it home, and a couple of years later, Sisko's putting together his first short story collection. And, you know, he asks, hey, what do you think I should put in? And so we tell him. And, you know, he goes and uses some of that, but some of that he doesn't. And the book comes out, and I said, why the hell didn't you use knife hands? Oh, you know, I was looking at that, and I thought, you know, that just, it wasn't very good, so I destroyed it. What do you mean you destroyed it?
Okay.
Yeah, I got rid of it. It doesn't exist anymore. So Joe Polvert, his evil bastard, has got a hard copy in his file cabinet, in his Michael Sisko file. And it may have taken me 15 years, but next month, here comes this lost Sisko work. And go back to Dickinson, go back to Kafka. When you're gone, if you don't go burn it tomorrow, somebody's going to read it and go, God damn, that woman was fucking brilliant. What a great book. It's entirely possible your opinion sucks. Okay? Sisko thought
could
this
be.
Was...
No, absolutely, and the writer is not always the best judge of their own work, but burning Sisko it... sorry, that thing's out of here.
But Sisko thought this particular work was no good. He destroyed it. And when I got the opportunity to curate this project, I reached out to somebody. I reached out to Paul Tremblay. I said, hey, you want to do an introduction for this? If you think anything of the novella, send it to me. I sent it to Paul. So Paul Tremblay writes this glowing introduction. He's knocked out. He's like walking around a few inches. His feet aren't touching the floor after reading this. Often writers don't know shit about their own work.
Agreed.
I'm sorry.
Agreed. That's fine. No, but the point is it's still in my hallway closet, though.
That's great.
Possession is 9/10 of the law, right?
Only I'm 60 years old. I won't be around.
I know. Well, none of us will be around. That's okay. We'll all be living on tiny little floating islands of garbage. And no one will we'll be telling a lot of our stories orally from here on out.
No.
We should probably develop a very good oral tradition once again, because times are about to get tight. So, but it is, I mean, it's true. There are lots of works you would hope to get the complete version of anybody's works whose works you admire. I mean, I would walk over broken glass if someone said, there's a brand new Christopher Marlowe play that was just like dug up in Deptford. I'd be like, what? Give me that.
Yeah.
But on the other hand, you don't want to present anything that you don't feel is your best work to people who read you. You want it to be very best that you can do, right? So.
Yeah.
I know at least two authors who, when presented with their first couple of novels, will offer to buy them and then will shred them right in front of me.
Once it's in print, though, then I feel differently about it. It's like it's in print. Now it exists as an artifact. And, I mean, it's just me. It's an artifact. It's already out there in the world. And it, once the books are gone, once they're away from you in that sense, they don't really belong to you anymore.
They
moves away. You know, you don't say, hey, I need you to do this and that. It's like, no, they're living their own life now, and you should be living your own life too.
Yeah, you're their mother. You give birth to the book. It goes out in the world. It grows up. You know, it may grow up to be a rocket scientist. It may grow up to be a garbage collector. Perhaps your child has autism. It is what it is. One of the things I hate is 20 years later, and we're reissuing this book, and author A decides, you know what, I'm a lot better writer than I was back then, so I'm going to clean this book up. That's unfair. I have a first novel. I could go back, and it could be a lot better than it was.
Totally, it's better, right?
But it is what it is.
And that comes down to a question of, you know, what does any creator owe the audience, and what's your responsibility to your work and to what you want for it and what you want it to give to other people. So, and you would hopefully, you look at stuff that you did 20 years ago and go, damn, I'm a lot better. Michael, stay awake.
I'm awake.
I'm what? I'm here. I'm listening. No, it ultimately doesn't belong to any of us, right? You put it out there and it speaks to people however it speaks. And, you know, who knows what kind of archival systems we're going to have in some of the stories, some of my old stories. If no paper hard copy exists, I would not be able to access them because the media on which they're stored is corrupt now, and I can't get at those stories. So there's that, too.
Yeah.
There's the search and retrieve system. I mean, who knows?
Well, guys, do we have any final questions for Kathe? Thanks for being on the show, Kathe.
Oh, totally.
I have one last question.
Sure.
We've talked about how multifaceted you are and how expansive your imagination is. Is there any trope that you haven't used that you think someday I want to do something with that?
I would love to do a picture book. I would love to do a picture book with Rick. But picture books to me are so difficult, and the economy required is a discipline as rigorous as haiku to do a really, really... Go look at a book like Where the Wild Things Are and count the words, count the actual number of words that Maurice Sendak used. And I think... was. And I would love to be able to do something like that. I don't know if I have the skills for it, but I would like to try.
I heard Dash the cat calling you.
I know, right? Dash has been so patient, and he is really losing it. He's in the corner of the room going, bitch, am I going to have to come over there? Because I don't want to come over.
Well, we
that's as good a way as any to say goodnight.
Yeah. Thank you for being on the show, Kathe. Really appreciate you coming on. It's great.
Thank you for having me. It was fun.
So we're going to talk about a few other things for a few minutes, but if you want to go, all you got to do is close the window, and I think it'll kick you out. So
I got to go. Bye, you guys. Thank you again.
Wonderful. Thanks.
Good to see you again. Thanks.
Okay. Thanks.
Okay, buddy. I hear you.
Bye. Oh, she's still on. There we go. Yeah. Okay. It's great talking with Kathe. So,
she's great. That was fabulous.
What?
I said she's great. That was fabulous.
Yeah.
A lot of fun.
California H.P. Lovecraft Film Festival is doing a Kickstarter.
I'm going to that. If I can get the time off work, I got permission from the boss.
Oh, good.
So if I do, I'll get tickets to the Kickstarter.
Yeah, I'm going to be there. Did you guys see Cody's video for that Kickstarter?
It's hysterical.
Yeah.
Guys,
that's one of the best Kickstarter videos I think I've ever seen.
He's like a volcanic talent, you know?
Yeah.
He's got a new collection coming out from Hippocampus.
Yes, he does.
I think it's Rapture from the Deep. Is that the title? I know it's got Rapture in it.
Actually, I have an email from Derek, so let me pull it up, the publisher, 1 second here. Because there's kind of a deal on that book, and I'll post this link. But, yeah, Rapture of the Deep by Cody Goodfellow, and it comes out in March. But the deal with the pricing on this book, if I understand this right, is if you pre-order it, it's $12.50 straight from Hippocampus Press. If you wait till it's available, it's $20. So you're getting quite a deal if you pre-order it.
Derek's been doing that type of thing with some of the fiction releases for a while now.
Okay.
Not every one, but some of them.
Okay. Well, seems like a pretty good deal, and Cody's a very, very talented writer.
Yeah.
So if you're looking for new Lovecraftian short fiction, there you go.
And you and I, Peter, are going to be in an anthology with Cody. That was Gaslight? Is it Gaslight Ghouls? Pete?
I'm sorry, I'm not getting any of that.
Gaslight Ghouls?
You and him are going to have an anthology called Gaslight Ghouls.
Gaslight Ghouls, yes. Yeah. Guys, let me come back in. I'm breaking up bad.
Okay, no problem.
I can't hear any of you anymore.
Well, speaking of Cody.
While we're talking about Cody and being as crazy as he is, and we all know he's certifiable, and it's called A New Atlas of Dream. And
what are you talking about?
Cody and I are editing a book together.
Okay.
And it's called A New Atlas of Dream, and it will explore the dreamlands.
This is great.
But this ain't your daddy's dreamlands. We want to look at modern man, modern sensitivity, modern consciousness, the dreamers who went into the dreamlands in Lovecraft era were a certain type of people, a certain type of humanity. And since then, we've had civil rights and two world wars and advances in medicine. We've been to the moon. We've had the pill. We've had Woodstock. We've had an information revolution. So the sensitivities and the consciousness of mankind has been radically altered. So what happens to man when he dreams now in the context of the dreamlands?
You know, one thing that I think is great about this is we kind of talked about this at the Necronomicon. There are just not that many books about the dreamlands compared to nothing tops Innsmouth, of course, but it's very, very few even individual stories set in the context of the Dreamlands. So this is going to be a really fascinating collection of works. Who's the publisher?
Yeah, we have what we feel is going to be a really strong table of contents as far as the people who have said they will submit. Everybody, the writers are thrilled with our concept. You know.
So. Who's the publisher?
PS Publishing.
Okay.
Oh, great. It'll be that's good and bad. The good thing is it'll be a gorgeous book.
Right. But
the bad thing is
hopefully, you know, we'll get a nice trade paperback as well, because I mean, Cody, me, Laird, here's another example. We want this material to be read. These expensive hardcovers are real nice, and I like having them on. I want books that I edit to be affordable so readers can read them. If there's a limited edition, cool. But most readers can't afford limited edition. I want readers. These things are projects that I love and I want to share. I want somebody to like get a kick out of this stuff. There's a lot of work that goes into making these books. These writers bleed these stories onto the page. I want the readers to get those benefits.
Well, speaking of Cody, he'll be on the show next week. So
that should be entertaining as all get out.
Yeah, yeah. I'm basically going to say I'm Mike Davis. This is a Lovecraft eZine show. Here's Cody Goodfellow, and that'll be it. That's all I'll need to say.
And also for everybody watching, if this Kickstarter reaches its goal, then Mike Davis doesn't have to go by his lonesome. He can bring his misfit bastard brother with him, and they can hang out and get into mischief together. That guy is Joe Polo, by the way. So kick in some pennies, folks, because I've never been in California, and who the hell knows that if I make it to California, hey, maybe the big earthquake will happen.
Yep, so hit the Kickstarter, help make it happen. Like I said, Cody will be on next week. Salome, you've got a new Ghostwoods Books has a new call for cosmic horror novels, right? Do I have that right?
Novels and novellas.
Novels and novellas, okay. So just what, go to ghostwoodsbooks.com?
Yeah. Okay. GWDbooks.com. And there's
GWDbooks.com, right.
You can find this call for submissions under the About Us tab.
Okay.
And so Cthulhu Live Streaming comes out soon, right? Like,
yeah.
Well, maybe technically the 25th, but perhaps the ebook is already available in some places. And
now you're looking for novellas. Are you going to do an anthology of novellas? Or are these standalone?
It depends on what we get. If we get, I was just thinking about it, we could put two novellas in a book, or three novellas. Probably only two, because I asked for 40,000 word minimum.
Well, all
so
right.
We'll just
so,
see.
Yeah. Anyone listening to this or watching this, you got a cosmic horror novel or novella, gwbooks.com, and then go, it's under the About Us tab, you said, right?
GWD Books.
GWD Books. I'm sorry.
Yeah, I just linked it to the eZine page.
Okay. And then what? Amazon's screwing around with you on the pre-order stuff? What are they doing? On Cthulhu is Dreaming, I mean. I didn't quite understand.
Every time that I... It's just switching it over toward the end something always appears to go awry. And when I did it today, they deleted everything. So all the formatting on the description, they deleted the editorial reviews.
Oh, great.
I wrote to them and said, you just did this. So it seems to have been reinstated now, although there are still some inexplicable errors. Like the American Amazon has Dennis Detweiler's name spelled wrong. I have pointed it out to them. Hopefully they will fix it.
Yeah, I asked this because I've been trying to decide whether to do the pre-order Amazon thing for Autumn Cthulhu. You know, but it's, if it causes problems, then I don't want to do it. Because I've not had problems before, but I've never done that.
How are you... What is the source of your books?
Writers, usually.
No, I mean, will they be printed?
What? Say that again? I'm sorry.
Where will they be printed? We don't have to talk about this now. We can talk about it later. But I think it depends on how the books are getting to them.
Ah, okay. All right. Well, I'll do some more research into it then.
I'm going to start reading that tomorrow.
Start rereading what?
No, start reading.
Oh, Cthulhu's Dreaming?
Yes.
Well, last question on Cthulhu's Dreaming, at least from me. You said the ebook's available. Do you mean the one you sent to us writers, or do you mean on Amazon?
It's available on Amazon.
Oh, no
kidding. It's on Amazon. They were really speedy. I popped it up there today, and it's already available.
Very nice.
It looks like there's a matchbook price.
There is. If you buy the book, you'll get the ebook for free, or you're able to get it for free.
I like that.
Yeah, okay, I see it. Pre-order on the paperback, and then if I click on the Kindle, buy now, $5.99. So that's a great price, actually. And you get to read a story by Pete Rolick, by Mike Davis, and I think there's some other people in there, too. I'm not sure.
There's some cool people in there. And the stories are... it's surprisingly good. I always feel like, well, this book won't turn out to be very good. Because, no, I mean, you know, you do an open call and you don't know what you will have access to. And even I'm looking at it, I'm like, yeah, this story will probably work. And trying to form this idea in my mind of what it's going to be like. And I was actually quite blown away when I read it at the end. I feel like I got so lucky. Not just in the stories, but in the way that they are ordered, because, you know, it's having a precise order for stories that is meaningful.
Right.
It seems a bit random, but the coincidences between some stories that got next to each other seem like they were on purpose. But I didn't even, maybe subconsciously, I recognized that they were there when I was putting them in order. It wasn't until I read it at the end that I was like, oh my God, this is like a universe. They seem to fit into a universe together. I was really quite pleased.
That's nice.
So you didn't do what I do? Print them all up and have them all over the floor and go this one and then that one. It's like doing a puzzle. And you keep moving them and you all of a sudden you go, Eureka, that's it, I'm done. And you go back the next day, and you look down, and you go, no, that can't be there. You pick this one up, and you go, well, maybe that one. And you, so it takes a week to like, figure out the order.
I have done that.
I do that every book. It's like, the only thing is I always discover which one goes first. I have that. So at least I have the beginning, and then it's, but
so if you read Kindle books, Cthulhu Lies Dreaming is already available. So just go to Amazon.
On Amazon. Is there a problem with my account or something?
Probably.
Your wife called Amazon, Matt. You're not allowed to do that anymore.
There, so. No more books.
You can't see it?
No, well, Amazon I ordered a paperback, but the the ebook is not showing up on my Amazon page. No.
Well, like I said, she called Amazon and said, no more fucking books for my husband.
You should be able to get the ebook for free.
I got multiple emails. She's going to have a hard time stopping.
They are not linked to each other yet. They're next to each other.
Yeah.
Yeah, so you have to click the actual Kindle tab.
That kind of takes work.
Yeah. Wow, one whole click. And Carpenter likes to pick on me as being the old guy here, huh? Goddamn whippersnappers.
All right, so
I'm older than all of you.
A couple years younger than you, that's it.
I just put this on the message board, so... All right, we got anything else to talk about? I was gonna talk a little bit about book promotion, but maybe we'll save that for next week.
Book motion? What's that?
I'm always up for book promotion.
No, I'm talking about not specific books, the process and the mindset and so forth. Yeah.
Cry big, cry more, toss and turn all night, drink if it's available to you. Raise your hand, Pete.
I'm dry at this point.
Oh, my God.
So I want to tell a really bizarre little story. So Saturday morning, a friend of mine, I won't mention his name, but we went down to Fort Lauderdale to a little show called Pulp Adventure Con, which is just starting.
Did you guys go there in a stolen car?
No.
Oh, okay. All right.
But, you know,
I'll shut up now.
I wanted to take a look and see what was going on and see if there's anything I could pick up. And the artist Alan Kozlowski was there. So I picked up some books from him, and you know, we talked for about an hour. And I signed some stuff for him that he publishes Inhuman magazine, and he has two of my stories in that. But as I'm standing there talking to him, this guy comes up behind me and says, "Mr. Rolick, I'm so glad you're here." I turn around and I'm looking at him. He's like, "I know you from someplace." He's like, "We're Facebook friends. I live in Miami. And I was hoping you would be here." And he reaches into this bag and he pulls out all his books.
Oh, my God. On the off chance that you would be there?
On the off chance that I would show up.
That's nice. That's a real fan.
Yeah.
And I'm like, no, oh, so that was fun. And meanwhile, there's this there's a guy who played the driver in The Godfather. He's there signing autographs, and all of a sudden I'm signing all this stuff, and he's like looking over like, "Who's this guy?"
Who's this guy hogging my glory?
Exactly. So
that was cool. You need someone to be with you who will like go over to him and say, "Did you see that? Pete Rolick's here." You'd be like, "What? What the hell?"
What character was the dryer in The Godfather? That name doesn't sound familiar.
No, he was the driver.
The driver.
The driver.
Okay, yeah, yeah.
Oh, he played the dryer.
So, yeah.
All right. So, Cody Goodfellow next week. Then, what we'll do is I don't know. We'll talk about this a little bit next week after Cody's done talking. That might run into 3 hours. You know.
Yeah, I'm going to need more beers.
Yeah, but you know, if you got your book published by a major publisher, that's one thing. You know, if you're being published in the small press, then you're doing most, if not all, of the promoting. And there's some good things that you can do to help your book. So anyway, we'll talk about that. So anyway, it was great talking with Kathe Koja, and thanks for being on, guys, and we'll see you next week with Cody Goodfellow. Oh, prizes.
Oh, yeah.
What are the prizes again, Matt?
All right. A hardcover copy of Ann Pilsworth's YA book, Summoned. It looks like it's the first book in a series now, because the sequel was published.
Okay.
And the very brand new release of Lovecraft Country.
Oh, I know I'm going to get a ton of emails on that one.
Yeah.
Yep.
All right, so If you want either one of those books, please email the Lovecraft eZine Prizes email address and put the title of the book in the subject of the email. And the email address is Lovecraft eZine Prizes, just like it sounds, all together, at gmail.com. Lovecraft eZine Prizes at gmail.com. And as always, I will draw the winner next Sunday in the morning or early afternoon sometime. So anybody listening this week, you've got a chance to get in on that. So
whenever you say that and say Lovecraft eZine Prizes all together, I expect it'll be like Airplane, and we'll all say Lovecraft eZine Prizes.
All together.
Lovecraft eZine.
Roger, roger. Got the vector, Victor.
Right.
Right. Otherwise, you'll get a message that says, Houston, we have a problem.
All right, we'll see everybody next week. Thanks.